So, thank you everybody for being here. I'm going to talk about quantum computers. Actually, a very basic introduction of quantum computers. I don't want to scare anyone, so it will be very basic, and my goal tonight will be to give you an idea of it, so that maybe I can awaken you some curiosity and you go farther with more formal study or knowledge, or what you want to do. You want to maybe play with it online. We will see during the presentation. First of all, like, why this talk? Why now? Because, these days we read, we hear, we see videos on YouTube about quantum computers. We read around the papers about quantum computers, news about quantum computers. We have a lot of companies that are investing on them, like the big ones we know, IBM, D-Wave, Google, Microsoft, and so on. And right now, it's the right moment because everyone is investing in it. The technology, the research is good enough that we feel that we are close to a final product. And also the impact of this product will be big. For example, Morgan Stanley studied that the high-end computing market will double from 5 billion to 10 billion. And that's crazy. So, what are quantum computers? Quantum computers are computers that are based on the laws of quantum mechanics. So I thought that to start, maybe I should refresh a bit what's the difference between classical physics and quantum physics. Well, classical physics is the physics we can use to describe the state of big objects, let's say like this. So, like, it works very good for big objects and less good for small objects. So for small objects, we switched to quantum physics that described them quite good. Quantum physics might work also for big objects. It's just that all the nice properties that brings are not visible. So we need to go in a small place, like at the end of this scale. And there we see all the nice properties of quantum physics, we can use them, and we can make quantum computers. So, what are these properties? Let's survive two of them that may be useful for understanding. So, for example, in classical physics, we know that classical physics is deterministic, so if we have initial condition of a system, we can always calculate the state future in the evolution. Quantum physics is not deterministic, so we can only talk about probabilities. So I can tell you with which probability the system will be in a certain state, but I cannot tell you that for sure it will be. Another difference is that classical physics is observer-independent, so the outcome of an experiment will always be equal. And quantum physics is observer-dependent, means that the observer influences the outcome of the experiment. Then some scientists in the past, like Feynman, said, can we use this property to build a more powerful machine, maybe? And they started to think about the quantum computer. And so to understand it, I thought it might be nice to start with a classical computer and switch to quantum to understand a bit the difference. The classical computer is based on bit. It is the unit of a computer. Maybe everyone of you heard about it. So a bit can be zero, can be or one. It's like a coin, can be tail or can be head. So if I have a bit, I can represent 2 to the n values. But there's a catch, only one per time, right? So if I have one bit, I can decide if this bit is one or zero. If I have two bit, I need to decide on the first one, let's say zero, and on the second one, let's say one. What's the difference with the quantum bit? The quantum bit, first of all, in real life, let's say like this, it's any two-state system that can be, for example, two levels in an atom, like the low level and the up level. The polarization of a photon, like the horizontal polarization or the vertical polarization. So whatever has two levels, let's go with the atom for today, it's not important for this talk. And the quantum bit has the special properties that can be one, can be zero, but can be also both of them, like a coin that is rotating, and we don't know if it's head or tail. What this does mean? It means that if I have n qubit, I can represent 2 to the n values, like a classical bit, but this time I can encode them all in parallel. So if I have 1 qubit, I can encode 0 and 1 at the same time. If I have 2 qubit, I can encode all the possible combinations, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, and so on till n. If I have n, I can encode all the possible combination of n, 0 and 1. What this does mean in numbers? Like, it's crazy, right? I mean, if I have 30 qubits, I can already represent more than 1 million of states in parallel at the same time. And that's cool, but it's not enough. We need to use other properties. Another properties that we need to use is, why this happened, This happened because of a property that is called superposition, right? And the superposition tells us that a system, it can be represented as superposition of the basic states. So for example, if I have a coin, the state of the coin can be represented as superposition of 0 and 1, with alpha and beta being the probability of being 0 or beta, or 1. I say probabilities, but take this with care. It's not, it's not really like this, but more or less. Another way to see it is like a vector in a sphere that goes from 1 to 0. And a qubit can have any position of this vector around the sphere. Things that doesn't happen with a classical bit, because the classical bit can be only 1 or 0. But as I said before, this is not enough. We need to use other properties. Another property is the entanglement, or what connection, let's say, if you want to say it. So what does the entanglement is? The entanglement is when two particles or two coins, doesn't work with the coins, are connected in a way that the state of one particle cannot be described independently from the second particle. What does mean? If I have two coins or particle that are rotating and they don't know the status, but I know that the results should be equal once I observe them. If I observe the first one and it's one, the second, I know automatically that the second one will be also one. It's like they are connected. And the same if I know that if the results should be opposite. So they are both rotating, I look at the first one, it's one, I know that the result of the other should be opposite, and I don't look at the other one, I already know that it's zero. That's a nice property. Both of them are nice properties. But they're not enough to have a powerful quantum computer, right? Because, okay, yeah, I mean, we have this massive parallelism, but it's all probability, so what do we do with them? I mean, where is the power? The power is in the algorithm. The algorithm is a set of steps, operations, if you want to call, or in technical language, gates, that allows you to manipulate the qubits and brings you to a result. Why the algorithm is so important? Because it's thanks to the algorithm that we can exploit these two properties, the superposition and entanglement, and get faster to the result, faster than a classical computer. Obviously for certain problems, but this is another long talk. So today I wanted to show you a few gates, so that you have the feeling of it, and then maybe you can go farther yourself. The first simple gate is the X gate, it's a negation. So if I have zero, I apply the gate, I get 1. If I have 1, I apply the gate, I get 0. Super simple. Let's go further. I can apply the gates to 2 qubits. So if I have 2 qubits, I can have the CNOT gates. I check the first qubit. If the first qubit is 0, I don't do anything. If the first qubit is 1, I switch the second one. So as you see in the image, if I have 0, 0, nothing happens. 0, 1, nothing happens. 1, 0, I switch the second one. 1, 1, I switch the second one. That's a nice gate. And the last one is the Adamar gate. Why is it this is nice? Because if I have a qubit or a coin that has initial state is known, like it's zero, I can apply the Adamar gate and get a superposition. Isn't this cool? I start from something that I know, I end up with something that I don't know. Why this is useful? So let's see for 2 qubits why it's useful. If I have 2 qubits that are zero and I apply the Adamar gate, I get the superposition of them. And then the total state is just the multiplication of those two states. So it's like 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. So with applying the Adamar gate, I get the superposition of all of them. And that's cool. I start for qubits and I reach this massive parallelism that I talked at the beginning. And this goes on, I mean, till n qubit, and then you have like all the possible combination in one state. Then, using these gates, I exploit the properties, not these and other gates, obviously, but more complicated one. I exploit all these nice properties of quantum physics, and I get results faster for certain group of problems. So, what I use the quantum computer for? Well, when you study physics, they explain you, hey, factorization, search algorithm, okay, that's boring, right? So today I wanted to say something funny, and I thought to go in a risky field. I know the technical people may not totally agree on this, but well, you can use them to improve the machine learning algorithm, right? We have an algorithm to improve our learning of our machine, And it's heavy. We need a lot of computational power, but we can exploit this superposition, this massive parallelism, and maybe make it faster. We can try to solve the tunneling salesman problem. What is it? I have a group of cities, and I need to optimize the path between them. And the only way to do this is to compute all the possible combination and then take the minimum one. So it's brute force. With quantum computers, maybe you can optimize this. I mean, there are studies of it. It's very complicated algorithm. We don't talk about this now. Market prediction. Maybe I can use quantum computer to see correlation in the data that I couldn't see normally with a classical computer. Or to optimize a machine learning algorithm that does market predictions and do better investment. And last but not least, to simulate quantum phenomena. Why? Because that's the reason why the quantum computer was proposed. I mean, Feynman said, hey, how do we simulate a quantum phenomena like an atom or whatever if we have a classical computer? We need to do approximation. Maybe we can simulate a quantum phenomena with a quantum device. And that's the reason why that's, the biggest field for now. And yes, we still don't have quantum computers. And okay, maybe I need to finish. I skipped it. We still don't have quantum computers ready and finished at home, I know. We have quantum computers in the cloud and with very few qubits. There are a lot of challenges to have a final quantum computer. So for now we are very limited. And also for the future, I don't think the idea is to have an end-to-end computer, but to have an hybrid, meaning I do a classical input, then I connect to the cloud, I use the quantum computer to optimize my research or my computation, I go out in a classical way with a single result. That's the most probable future. Obviously, in a very far future, we may have the full quantum device at home, but it's very hard because you need to keep these atoms in a very cold environment because they don't need to interact with the environment. I need to finish, ask me why in case later. So if this talk confuses you or scared you, don't be worried. I mean, Richard Feynman was the first one to think that quantum mechanics is very hard. People that study quantum mechanics still don't understand quantum mechanics. So no one is pretending you to understand quantum mechanics. But maybe now, having a bit of understanding of it, a small background, you can just trust physics. You know that it works, you know that there are experiments, or you know that there are peer review articles. You just use these properties that work, and maybe go further with your acquiring knowledge for quantum computer, quantum algorithm. And maybe one day you can write yourself your own quantum algorithm. And here you find a lot of cool stuff to do so. Also for beginners, people. And I'm done, thank you.
Thank you, Carlo. So, as usual, we have 5 minutes for the questions. So, if someone would like to ask a question, we have people with microphones here. So, please raise your hand.
Yeah.
Hi, can you hear me?
I can, but it doesn't work, but I can hear you.
Can you hear me
better? You can shout.
Is it green or red?
It's green.
Try again.
I'm trying.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Well, first of all, thank you for an interesting talk. That was really nice. Question, you said that the quantum computer lies in the future. If you talk about the first solution when you still use classical input and then the cloud, how far would that be, you think? How far would be the first solution when, you know, not a complete quantum device, but perhaps using a cloud with...
So, like, there are already, if you go here, you can already play with quantum computers offered by Google, IBM, and Microsoft. They are not, like, maybe still super powerful. I mean, I don't know the one that Google is doing with NASA, I mean, they have, but the public one maybe is still more simple, and you can already play with them, but I got your question, you mean more complicated stuff, like I said in the application part. There are people that say that we are 5-7 years away from it. But it's predictions, you know, it's all based on the research. The main problem of research, as I said, you need to... for now, we cannot put many qubits all together. I think the maximum right now is 50, but please correct me, Google people. because then you lose coherence and the properties I taught at the beginning, you lose them. If these atoms interact with the environment, atoms or qubits, whatever, interacts with the environment. So right now they keep this in a very cold environment, like few Kelvin, very few, almost 0 Kelvin. And And this makes them really kind of isolated from the environment. Not totally, but a bit. And there are studies to improve this.
Okay. So the limitation is kind of physical. Yeah.
Exactly. We still don't have maybe the technology or the knowledge how to really have a full functional quantum computers without these losing properties in time. For now, like this isolation of the atom lasts very few seconds. So you need all the operations you need to do. You need to apply like fast. And then it finished. So that's the limitation.
Sounds very complicated. So someone else would like to have a question? So
there's one there.
Please.
Yeah, thank you.
Wait 1 second.
Thank you for your talk. I mean, you said a lot about like the opportunities of quantum computing. What about the threats? What do you think about like our traditional encryption algorithms?
Yeah, as I said before, the first thing they teach you in physics in a quantum information class, it's the factorization stuff, that when you will have a quantum computer, you may have algorithms that are able to perform factorization of a number. And now our encryption is based on this theory that you have a very big number and you need to find the 2' number that gave it, and this is very, very hard problem, and quantum computer may do it, but that's not a problem. They are already working on algorithm for encryption and key distribution stuff,
So does it mean what the quantum approach also provides new ways of encryption?
It probably will provide. I mean, I don't know the state of art because I didn't go into encryption topic, but I know that may break the normal one, but the classical one, but I think they will provide a different way to encrypt it. I mean, right now there are what I read and studied about, it's this quantum key distribution is when you have a password and you want to distribute the key between two people that are far away and they use the entanglement. And this is already a way to overcome the classical problem, because then you have two particles that are entangled, and if there is some person that look at them, ruin the entanglement, you know that the key is not safe. I mean, it's more complicated than this, but I'm making it very short, so I hope I answered it.
Cool, so we have time for one more question, if someone would like. Okay, no question. Thank you.
Thank you.